Hello friends, till now we have studied the volcanoes, distribution of the volcanoes in the world and how are the volcanic eruptions occurring. Now when the volcanic eruptions are occurring, we also studied what are the different type of volcanic eruptions in the terms of shallow volcanic eruptions and in the terms of violent volcanic eruptions. So, and we have related it with the plate tectonic theory, that how does the shallow volcanic eruption affect the, that is how does the plate tectonic theory explains the shallow volcanic eruption, where do the shallow volcanic eruptions takes place and how it is different from the violent volcanic eruptions. Now coming to the next part of our topic, which is very important, though there in your books you will find this topic mentioned in the chapter of rocks. I am taking it here so that there is a continuity in the volcanic landforms. We will be doing an important topic known as landforms made by the volcanoes. So the landforms which are formed by the volcanic eruption is the next topic. What are the different kind of landforms made by a volcanic eruption? Whenever the volcanic eruption occurs, now how, what is your idea of a general kind of a landform made by a volcanic eruption? See, in anywhere in the world there is a sedimentary rock. The sedimentary rocks, just for, we will do this thing in detail again while doing the chapter of rocks. You just remember there are three different kind of rocks. One is the igneous rock, which is formed from the fire. Fire means volcanoes. So volcanoes will result into kind of an igneous rocks. Second, some of the rocks after they are formed, they are broken down, brought down by the agents of erosion, compacted by the different materials, maybe water, maybe different kind of materials will cement together to form a different kind of a rock. So these are the rocks which have been formed due to breaking down of the original rock structure. Such rocks are known as sedimentary rocks. The third kind of a rock, the parent rock, maybe it is subjected to extreme pressure. For example, if a parent rock is below a mountain, or the parent rock is below a man-made structure such as a big dams, or it is subjected to extreme temperature. For example, if there is a rock structure and it is being subjected, if this is an original rock and suddenly there is a volcanic eruption in between, then the rock in this surrounding region where the volcano is flowing will be subjected to extremely high heat, that is this part of the rock and this part of the rock. So when you know that if you take a paper, burn it, its property changes. So whenever there is a change in the property of the existing rock due to extreme pressure and or due to extreme temperature, it is known as metamorphic rock. Now, so today we are going to study the landforms made by volcanic eruption. Volcanic eruption means fire, molten rock material. So these landforms which are made by volcanic eruption are nothing but the igneous rocks which are found on the earth. So we are doing one type of a rock structure, which is an igneous rock. So the volcanoes result into igneous, makes after the magma, volcanoes result into upwelling of magma. It flows as a lava. The lava then solidifies, giving us the igneous rocks. If the lava means, when I say lava solidifies, then you should remember that anything outside the surface of the earth. When I say magma solidifies, you should know that it's anything inside the surface of the earth. So in this bedding planes of sedimentary rock, the sedimentary rocks are generally arranged in a parallel manner on the surface of the earth. On this bedding planes of the sedimentary rock, suppose there is a volcanic eruption from the mantle. The volcano rises from the mantle and after some time it rises and it comes up, it will result into formation of either volcanic mountain. It may result into formation of a volcanic plateau. That is, what is a plateau? A flat table land having a steep side. So it will result into formation of a volcanic plateau. Or sometimes the magma may be solidified inside the surface of the earth in different forms. So it may take a lens shape, it may take a perpendicular shape, it may take different shapes. So based on this, just a general idea, so that means the volcanic landforms which are formed on the surface of the earth, they can be formed outside the surface of the earth or they can be formed inside the surface of the earth. When a volcano is such that it cannot reach the surface of the earth, maybe because it is not that fluid, it is more viscous. What volcano is more, what magma is more viscous? We have done it. Acidic magma is more viscous. So acidic magma, because it is very viscous, it does not reach the surface of the earth and it solidifies inside the surface of the earth, resulting into the forms of landforms known as intrusive landforms. While on some magma may reach the surface of the earth and get solidified after flowing for a larger distance. Now, which magma has a greater chance of reaching the surface of the earth? It is the basic magma, that is the basaltic magma. Why? Because it is more fluid. So it will result into kind of a landforms which are outside of the surface of the earth, and therefore they are known as extrusive landforms. Now this volcanic landforms, just this is a general idea. If you are not very clear, I will come to it again while doing the rocks. But just you know that the landforms made by the volcanic eruption are of two types. Intrusive, that is when the magma solidifies inside the surface of the earth, or extrusive, that is the magma after coming on the surface of the earth, it solidifies. So we are going to study two kind of landforms, that is intrusive landforms and the extrusive landforms. So the volcanic landforms can be divided into intrusive landforms and extrusive landforms. So what is the differentiation? What is the difference between the intrusive landforms and the extrusive landforms? Intrusive landforms are the result of first cooling and solidification of magma. Cooling and solidification of magma or molten material below the surface of the earth. Again, what is intrusive landform? When the magma or lava solidifies below the surface of the earth, these are known as intrusive landforms. So solidification of magma or lava below the surface of the earth results into formation of an intrusive landforms. While the extrusive landforms are those landforms in which, not magma here, lava, due to cooling and solidification of lava, above the surface of the earth. It results from cooling and solidification of lava due to above the surface of the earth. Now the extrusive landforms or intrusive, this both cooling and solidification of a lava results into anything. When it is cooled and solidified, it will result into formation of a crystals. One of the basic characteristics of the igneous rocks are they are crystalline rocks. That is, these are the rocks which are having crystals. Just have a brief idea here. I will come to again when I will start teaching you the rocks. Now, the crystalline rocks, igneous rocks, are crystalline rocks. They are having small crystals. Why is this crystals? This are the crystals are formed due to cooling and solidification of hot molten water. Take your water and put it in the freezer, or put it in a very fast freezer. You will see the difference of what I am talking. If you put it in a normal freezer, it will cool very slowly, and as a result of it, there will be some large crystals which will be formed on the water when it turns into ice. You put it in extra fast freezer, which comes into nowadays in most of the refrigerators, there is a compartment in which there is a fast ice making shelf. You put it that put there and you see the difference of the water there you will have very small crystals. So the igneous rocks are the crystalline rocks. So this intrusive and extrusive landforms, that is, they are formed due to volcanic eruption. That means they are igneous rocks. These are also crystalline. Now if the question comes to you in the examination that which rock is more crystalline, intrusive or extrusive, what will be your answer? Apply your logic. Where is more heat, inside the surface of the earth or outside the surface of the earth? We have studied it is inside the surface of the earth. Outside there is not much major heat as compared to the inside surface of the earth. So the landform which is formed inside, that is intrusive landforms, they are having larger crystals than the extrusive landforms. Why? The difference is because the intrusive landforms are cooled and solidified very slowly. As a result, there is large time, more time for the development of crystals on the rock, resulting into this being more crystalline rocks. On other hand, the extrusive landforms, they are cooled at a very, very slow rate. The extrusive landforms, they are cooled at a very fast rate on the surface of the earth, resulting into formation of a smaller crystals. Why? Because there is no time for the development of the crystals. Fast rate of cooling, therefore very small crystals. With extremely slow rate of cooling, therefore large crystals. How do you apply this in your practical life? There are two types of rocks which are major igneous rocks, which you are going to study which you should know as a general study student. One is a basaltic rock, while the other is granitic rock. Granite you must have seen in your house. You remember that granite is an intrusive landform, intrusive igneous rock. So you see the granite, there will be large amount of crystals on it. On other hand, if you are ever going to the Deccan Plateau region, if you are ever going to the Western Ghat region, if you ever go to the famous hill stations of the Western Ghat region, you see the basalt rock, or you can Google it, see the basalt rock, it will be black color rock where the crystals will not be visible. Why is that? Because you remember that basalt is an extrusive landforms. So intrusive landforms result, example granite results into formation of larger crystals. The deeper the intrusive landform, more larger will be the crystals. The closer the intrusive landform to the surface, it will be cooled at a relatively faster rate compared to the deeper rock. As a result, the crystals will be smaller. On the surface of the earth, crystals will be still smaller. So as a result of this, the igneous landforms or the volcanic landforms are known as igneous rocks. Igneous rocks can be classified into intrusive rocks and extrusive rocks. We will again do this in rocks. So these are classified into intrusive landforms and the extrusive landforms. The intrusive landforms are crystalline. While the extrusive landforms are also crystalline, but the difference is larger crystals, smaller crystals. The best example I see, look at your floor. If it is a granitic floor, you will see there are crystals on it. On the other hand, basaltic rock won't have much crystals on it. So these are the two different kind of landforms. So what you have to remember, intrusive landforms are having larger crystals, due to slow rate of cooling, are having larger crystals due to the slow rate of cooling of magma inside the earth. Here, as the magma cools at a faster rate, lava cools at faster rate, there is less time for development of crystals and therefore smaller crystals are formed. What is the best example of intrusive landform? As I told you, example is granite rock. Here the example is basalt. These are the two landforms. So you should, when you say basalt, you should know that when the word basalt is asked, you should know that it is an extrusive landform, form of a basic lava. When you say granite, acidic, intrusive landforms. So when you say intrusive, that means larger crystals. Extrusive, that means smaller crystals are formed. Now the intrusive landforms are further divided into on where they are located. They are further divided into plutonic landforms and into hypabasal landforms. So these are the two types of intrusive landforms, that is the plutonic landforms and the hypabasal landforms. So now in a Greek mythology, word Pluto, the god, there is a god Pluto, and god Pluto represents underworld, that is the world which is deep inside the earth. So Lord Pluto or god Pluto is a god of deep inside the earth, and hence the rocks which are formed deep inside the earth are known as plutonic landforms, while the rocks, again, which rocks? Intrusive rocks, which are found near the surface of the earth, but again beneath the surface but nearby the surface of the earth, are known as hypabasal landforms. So we can say it is like this. If this is the surface of the earth, the rock landforms, igneous landforms which are found near the surface of the earth, they will be known as hypabasal landforms, which will be formed deep inside the surface, inside the earth, they are known as plutonic landforms. If this is the entire earth, so this will be the plutonic landforms. Why plutonic? Because the name is derived from the god Pluto, who is the god of fire, god of underworld. And here, this near the surface of the earth, they are hypabasal landforms, while outside the surface of the earth, this will be extrusive landforms. So plutonic landforms are, what is the classification? What plutonic landforms are formed very deep inside the surface of the earth? While the hypabasal landforms are formed near just beneath, or we can say near the surface of the earth, or just below the surface of the earth. So the difference between plutonic is very deep inside the earth and just below the surface of the earth. Now the next question comes is, in the terms of crystals, which landform will be more crystalline, plutonic landforms or hyperbasal landforms? What you know about the crystals? Jitna deep inside the surface of the earth, more time because of more heat inside the surface, so larger crystals. Based on this analogy, plutonic landforms will be having more crystals. Just below the surface of the earth, less heat and therefore comparatively smaller crystals. Therefore, in these two, the hyperbasal will be having comparatively smaller crystals. Smallest crystals outside the surface of the earth in the extrusive landforms. So these are more crystalline. Or we can say they are having larger crystals. And these are having comparatively smaller crystals. So the volcanic landforms again are divided on the basis of their location into the intrusive landforms and the extrusive landforms. Intrusive landforms are formed due to the cooling and solidification of a magma below the surface of the earth, while the extrusive landforms are formed due to cooling and solidification of lava above the surface of the earth. The intrusive landforms, because they are below the surface of the earth, they are having larger crystals due to the slow rate of cooling of the magma, while the extrusive landforms, they are having smaller crystals because of the faster rate of the cooling of the crystals. Now the intrusive landforms are further divided into plutonic landforms and the hyperbasal landforms. Plutonic landforms are found very, very deep inside the earth. Therefore, larger crystals in the, as compared to the hyperbasal landforms, which are found just below the surface of the earth, and therefore comparatively smaller crystals. Example is granite rock is an example of an intrusive landform. Basalt, flood basalt, black cotton soil. Why it is known as black cotton soil? Because it is black in color. What is soil? It is found on the surface of the earth. Black cotton soil is made from basalt. So you remember that basalt is an example of an extrusive landforms. So with this, we will go to the next topic. That is, what are the different kind of an intrusive landforms? The questions will be, describe the landforms made by an volcano. You have to mention both, but you have to be very quick while discussing this. Introduction, that is intrusive landforms, extrusive landforms. Then after that, what are the different types of intrusive landforms? What are the different types of extrusive landforms? So, see, on the surface of the earth, generally the topmost layer of the earth's crust, I am talking of this layer, the topmost layer of the earth's crust, that is only on the topmost layer, not deep inside, on the crust, the entire crust is covered by the sedimentary rocks. Now the sedimentary rocks are similar to the table cloth which we put on the table. That is a very thin covering the entire surface of the earth. Why are the sedimentary rocks formed? I told you the word sedimentary means the rocks which are formed due to the breaking down of either igneous rocks or any kind of a parent rock. So obviously the first rocks to be formed on the surface of the earth were igneous rocks, and then there were the rocks were broken down by what? By our, remember the lecture of earth's movement, by our extrusive forces, by our exogenetic forces. So you remember that lecture, exogenetic forces result into gradation, that's why they are known as denudational forces, and as a result of this they bring down the height of the surface of the earth. Endogenetic forces, mountain building. Exogenetic forces, erosion. How do erosion? It is not that the river comes and takes the Himalayas. Little by little, brick by brick, we say, or sand by sand, or particle by particle, the rock will be broken and deposited as sediments, resulting into formation of a soil. How they will be laid down? They will be laid down by the agents of erosion, such as wind, such as water, rivers bring down the soil. How is the river water? Is it very crystal clear, just like your drinking water? No, it is muddy. It becomes more muddy during the season of floods, during the rainy season. Why? Because it is carrying more mud with it. What is this mud? This mud is nothing but sediment. When the water level decreases, the mud is deposited in the surrounding region. These are the sedimentary rocks. How are they? Generally, the sedimentary rocks are deposited in the flat, in a parallel manner. These are known as the bedding planes of the sedimentary rock. Below that lies the mantle which carries the magma, which carries the molten material known as magma. Now this molten material, when it comes out and if it solidifies before reaching the surface of the earth, it results into formation of an intrusive landforms. And this intrusive landforms, based on their shape, based on their size, are called by different names for our understanding. So when the magma comes up from below, or if it gets solidified below the surface of the earth into a large block, some magma comes up like a volcanic plug and results into formation of a volcanic. It will result into formation of large amount of volcanic mountain. Now obviously this is an extrusive landform. This is just for your understanding how the volcanic mountain is formed. Some magma will go and it will solidify as a parallel to the bedding plane of a sedimentary rock. Some magma will solidify perpendicular, it will go up from here, resulting into perpendicular solidification of a bedding plane. Some magma will solidify in this kind of a shape. What is this? Bowl like or saucer shaped topography. Some magma will again it will go along like this, resulting into formation of a solidifies inside, some reaches outside and solidifies as a flat land known as lava plateau or lava plains. Again an extrusive landform. Some of the magma or lava goes up and solidifies as a large dome-like structure. Some magma or lava will go and solidify in a lens-like format. So, based on the different shapes taken by the landforms, there are different names given to the landforms due to the solidification of magma or lava. The different names given to the landforms are, when the magma solidifies as a very very large block, as a big mass of a granitic rock. Why granitic? Generally found inside the earth is granite. It is when it solidifies as a large block of magma. You can take this down. When it solidifies as a very large block of large granitic rock, which generally lies at the foot of a mountain, which is generally never exposed due to erosion on the ground surface. Why? Because to erode, to expose this structure, it is a very large structure, to expose this structure, there has to be erosion of the entire this bedding planes. Such a very large mass of an granitic rock or intrusive igneous rock, which lies deep inside the earth, generally forms the foot of a mountain, never exposed to the ground surface, is known as by the word batholith. What it is known as? Batholith. What does the word lith means? The word lith means rock. So the lith means rock. So what are the batholiths? You can take down. Batholiths are large masses of intrusive igneous rocks found deep inside the earth. They are usually made of granite and they form the base of a mountain and are seldom exposed on the ground surface. So again, I am repeating, what are batholiths? Batholiths are large mass of igneous rocks found deep inside the earth, seldom exposed to the ground surface, generally made up of granite, and they form the base of a mountain or root of a mountain surface. So the batholiths are, these are the batholiths. Then there is another definition. Another is sill. The word sill. Now, the sills are defined as the intrusive igneous rock which is parallel to the bedding plane of a sedimentary rock, which is horizontal or parallel to the bedding plane of a sedimentary rock. So the kind of a rock, intrusive igneous rock, which becomes parallel or horizontal to the bedding plane of a sedimentary rock is known as the sill. Now look at this diagram. Where is the sill? Is it parallel to the bedding plane? No, it is vertical, perpendicular to the bedding plane. This is a rock structure which is parallel to the bedding plane. Forget about this structure I have made. So the kind of a rock structure which is parallel to the bedding plane of a sedimentary rock is known as sill. So in this diagram, this is the sill. So intrusive igneous rock, which is parallel to the bedding planes of a sedimentary rock, or which are horizontal, are known as sills. While the other intrusive igneous rocks, which are perpendicular to the bedding planes of a sedimentary rock, consider the sill is this way, which are perpendicular to the bedding planes of a sedimentary rock, or which are somewhat vertical, it may be totally perpendicular or it may be somewhat vertical, are known as the word dikes. What are the dikes? The intrusive igneous landforms, which are vertical or somewhat vertical, generally perpendicular to the bedding planes of the sedimentary rock, is dike. Look at this diagram, find out where is this dike. This is the sediment, this is a plug. This is a flow of a lava. This is known as conduit. You forget about the middle subsection. But you see this landform. Is it parallel to the bedding plane? No, it is perpendicular to the bedding plane of a. This is the bedding plane of sedimentary rock. This is perpendicular to the bedding plane of a sedimentary rock. It is vertical. So it is an example of an dike. One more example of a dike is here, not perfectly perpendicular, but again it is not parallel, it is not horizontal, it is somewhat vertical. So kind of an igneous rocks in which is somewhat vertical, which is perpendicular to the bedding plane of a sedimentary rock, is known as dike. The best example is this. Dike may not be exposed on the ground surface. Somewhere the dike may be exposed on the ground surface. When it is exposed on the ground surface, it forms, and if the river is flowing on from that dike, it will result into waterfall. So what is a dike? A kind of igneous intrusion or igneous intrusive rock, which is perpendicular to the bedding planes of a sedimentary rock, is known as dike. The third is the fourth one is lopolith. So what is a lopolith? The lopolith is again an intrusive igneous rock, because we are doing intrusive igneous rock. It is an intrusive igneous rock which is saucer shaped or bowl shaped. How is saucer? Is saucer flat? No, saucer is somewhat curved in the between. It is like a depression. So an intrusive igneous rock which is shallow or which is having a depression, which is a saucer shaped, is known as lopolith. Come to this diagram. Which is the saucer shaped intrusive igneous rock? This is the saucer shaped intrusive igneous rock. So it is an example of an lopolith. Write in the blue plane, so blue pen, so that it is easier for you to understand. So a saucer shaped or shallow basin having a depression in the middle, or a saucer shaped intrusive igneous rock, is known as lopolith. So this is an example of an lopolith. Now come to next igneous rock. It is known as laccolith. What is a laccolith? The laccolith is defined as large mound, large mountain shaped intrusive igneous rock, not extrusive. Extrusive, it will become hill or a mountain, it will become a volcanic cone. So large mound of an igneous rock, large mound or mountain of an igneous rock, which is having a pipe like conduit, which is having a pipe from below, is known as a laccolith. Or we can say in a simple word, that is a mushroom shaped igneous rock, is known as a laccolith. Now come to this diagram. Where is the laccolith? Where is the mushroom shaped igneous rock? Which igneous rock looks like having a large mound from below? It is this. So this is an example of a laccolith. So what is laccolith? It is a mushroom shaped large mound of an igneous rock. It is a mushroom shaped large mound of an igneous rock. You correct the spelling here. Which is having a pipe like conduit, or which is having a pipe from below. Now the last kind of an intrusive igneous rock, we are not referring to this one outside because they are extrusive. We are referring to only inside intrusive igneous rocks, The last kind of an intrusive igneous rock is phacolith. What are these phacoliths? Phacoliths are lens shaped. These are like contact lenses, lens shaped. What do you mean by lens shaped? They are not like large mound like laccolith, but they will be having some kind of an lens shape. Lens shaped igneous rock which occupy the top of an anticline or which occupy the bottom of a syncline are known as phacoliths. So phacoliths are lens shaped which occupy the top of an anticline. This is an anticline structure, so which occupy the top of an anticline or bottom of a syncline are known as phacoliths. So in this diagram, this is an phacolith. So this are the six types of intrusive igneous rock. If the magma comes out and flows out as lava, it will result into formation of a volcanic mountain. So this is an extrusive igneous rock. The top of a volcanic mountain will be blown away, which is known as crater. The crater is another kind of an intrusive igneous rock, extrusive landform, or it will result into formation of a flat table like landform which is having steep sides from below, resulting into formation of a volcanic plateau. But we are doing intrusive igneous landform. So the intrusive igneous landforms are of six types: batholith, sills, dikes, lopolith, laccolith, phacolith. What is a batholith? A large mound of an igneous rock. Or we can say large mass of an igneous rock found deep inside the earth. Generally forms base of a mountain or root of a mountain. Is batholith. So this is a batholithic structure. What is a sill? Horizontal igneous rock. And parallel to what? Bedding plane of a sedimentary rock. Rock is silt. What is a dike? Dike is perpendicular and vertical. Vertical to what? Bedding planes of sedimentary rock. What is lopolith? Lopolith, again a saucer shaped depression. What is laccolith? Mushroom shaped. But you remember, it has a pipe from below. What is a phacolith? It is a lens shaped. Intrusive igneous rock is a phacolith. So these are the different types of an intrusive igneous rock. You can have a look at the diagram for some time, and the best thing is if you will take down this diagram. So take down this diagram. These are the different types of intrusive igneous rock formations. just have a look at this diagram. These are the different types of intrusive igneous rock formations. Okay. Before I go to the next topic, the extrusive igneous rocks. So again, remember that we are doing the intrusive igneous rocks. We have finished with the intrusive igneous rocks. Now, the next topic is extrusive igneous rocks. Generally, the volcanic topography on the top of the earth will look like this. What is this? It is an example of a volcanic plateau. What are this? These are examples of volcanic cones. See, any kind of a volcanic mountain is generally represented as funnel shaped mountain. Block mountain is generally represented as this way. The fold mountain is generally represented as this kind of a mountain. That means signifies different kind of a foldings inside the mountain. What does this show? That this shows that whatever, even if the mountain is a fold mountain or a block mountain, due to volcanic activity, the top of a mountain has blown away and through which the volcanic gases comes out. This is shown as a fold mountain. So any kind of a volcanic mountain will have a depression in the center of a mountain. Generally, in the center of a mountain, this is known as a crater or volcanic crater. This is known as an volcanic craters. So the extrusive volcanic landforms or the extrusive volcanic landforms or the extrusive volcanic extrusive igneous rocks, we won't be defining them as an extrusive igneous rocks. We will say that they are the shapes of a different landforms, obviously made from the igneous rock. So the extrusive igneous rocks can be divided into cones, crater, plateaus, and in some cases plains. That is the volcanic plain, a flat land which is not having a steep side from below is known as a plain, while plateau is known as a table land. How is your table? Flat but having very steep sides from below. So the plain region is a region which is not having a steep sides, while the plateau region is a region which is having steep sides from below. So the extrusive volcanic landforms are divided into cones, craters, plateaus and plains. The cones, as it can be seen in the diagram, will be of different sides. So we will be further dividing the cones, then plateaus and then plains. Now these extrusive igneous landforms, especially, they are very, very important from the preliminary point of view, because they will ask you the examples of an volcanic plateaus in the world. They will give you four options, for example, Deccan Plateau, Iceland, Columbia Snake Plateau and the name of any other plateau, and they will ask you which of them is a volcanic plateau, or what are the different types of the cones. Obviously, why the shape of this cone is lower than this cone, or why this cone, the last one cone, is having the lowest shape than this cone, but it is having a very different shape than this cone, so resulting into different types of cones. So based on this, we will divide the extrusive igneous landforms into cones, that is volcanic cones. On the top of a cone there is a crater. Volcanic plateau. And volcanic plain. What is the difference between a plateau and a plain? The difference is a flat land having a steep sides is known as a volcanic plateau. Plain is a relatively flat land without a steep side. So you don't have to remember into too much detail the plateau and the plain region. Only thing you have to remember the examples of this. So volcanic cones are further divided based on their size into ash and cinder cones. Parasitic cones. And lastly, a kind of cones known as basic lava cone. So the volcanic landforms are divided, extrusive igneous volcanic landforms are divided into cones, crater, plateaus and plains. So we will be studying these cones into detail. The cones are further divided into ash and cinder cones, composite cones, parasitic cones and basic lava cones. Now first, coming to ash and cinder cones, as the name suggests, they are mostly made up of ash or dust materials or pyroclastic fragmental materials. Just to give you a very brief idea, ash and cinder cones are made up of dust materials, pyroclastic material, that is the fragments which come out during the volcanic eruption. We have done it in the previous part of volcanoes, that is these are the made up of lapilli, bombs, pea-sized shape, dust, volcanic ash. So the lava cones, the ash and cinder cones are the cones which are formed due to the pyroclastic material, which are formed due to ash, volcanic ash, etc. Then on the other hand, the composite cones are the cones which are formed due to cementation of alternate layers of pyroclastic material, lava. Pyroclastic material, lava. Here there is less dominance of lava, here there is more dominance of lava. Now compared to these two cones, because there is a more lava here, it is made up of layers of lava and pyroclastic material. The lava here acts as a cementing material. It is a molten rock, so it acts like a cement, that it flows. And once it gets solidified, it compacts those molten materials, it compacts those pyroclastic material, and as a result, composite cones are the highest and the most loftiest volcanic mountains in the world. Some of these bigger mountains, because the volcano does not have that much power on the bigger mountain to go to the top of the mountain, sometimes very small cones develop on the large cones. Obviously these cones are known as the parasitic cones. And lastly, basic lava cones are the kind of cones which are formed due to basic lava, and because they are formed due to basic lava, they go for very large distance before solidifying, therefore they are known as shield volcanoes. So the cones are divided into ash and cinder cones, composite cones, parasitic cones and the basic lava cones. Now we will do each and every cone in detail. These are the different kind of landforms, that is the cones craters. Now studying each of these landforms individually, we will first study the different types of cones. That is the ash and cinder cones, composite cones, parasitic cones and the basic lava cones. You know, if the question is on the landforms, you are expected to write a little bit about this kind of a cones. So the first cone is the ash and cinder cones. See, have a look at this before I rub the figure. The ash and cinder cones are the cones which are formed due to the ash and pyroclastic material. Because they are formed due to ash and pyroclastic material, there is general absence of lava, or the lava is very less, and as a result of this, they do not attain a great height. These are the smaller cones which are as compared to the composite cones, because the composite cones are made up of larger materials, or the composite cones are made up of magma. So the ash and the cinder cones are the cones formed due to, you can take down, these are the formed due to unconsolidated material due to accumulation such as ash and pyroclastic material, formed due to the accumulation of unconsolidated materials such as ash and pyroclastic materials. These are formed of volcanic dust and fragmented matter such as pyroclastic material. Hence, they are of lower height as compared to the They are of lower height as compared to other type of cones known as composite cones. So these are of lower height as compared to the composite cones, formed of ash and unconsolidated material during a volcanic eruption, represented by a single diagram which shows that they are formed of ash and unconsolidated material. Now the second type of a cone is composite cones. Here the definition is, these composite cones are formed due to alternate layers of lava and unconsolidated materials. So these are the cones which are formed. These are the cones which are formed due to accumulation of alternate layers of lava and fragmental matter. Because there is a presence of lava, lava acts as cementing material. And because there is a proper cementation, these are highest of all volcanic cones. These are the highest of all volcanic cones. Therefore, they are known as stratovolcanoes. So, what are the composite cones? Formed due to alternate layers of or accumulation in the different layers of volcanic materials and lava. The lava acts as a cementing material, results into compaction. Compaction results into this are the highest of all cones, and they are known as the stratovolcanoes. They can be represented in diagram like this. Now, where there is an alternate layer of lava, lava is coming out, getting deposited. Then the next layer is of fragmented matter, that is pyroclastic material. Again, a layer of lava. Layer of fragmented matter. So, the kind of cones which are formed due to the alternate layers of lava and pyroclastic material. Are known as composite cones, or lava and the pyroclastic material is known as the composite cone. We have already done what are the pyroclastic materials. All the highest volcanoes in the world are made up of composite cones. The examples of the volcanoes of the composite cones are what are the important volcanoes we did? If you remember the previous lecture, we did some of the important volcanoes, that Mount Cotopaxi, the highest volcanic mountain in the world, the highest volcanic mountain in the world is made up of, is an example of Mount Mayon. Which country? Philippines. Mount Shasta, USA. Mount Fujiyama, Japan. Mount Krakatoa, Indonesia. These all are examples of composite volcanoes. So the composite volcanoes are formed due to the accumulation of alternate layers of lava and fragmented matter, where lava acts as a cementing material, and these are the highest of all volcanoes in the world. These are also known as the stratovolcanoes, and the examples are Mount Fujiyama, Japan, Mount Cotopaxi, Ecuador, which is the highest mount, volcanic mountain in the world, Mount Mayon in Philippines, Mount Shasta, USA, and Mount Krakatoa in Indonesia, in the island of Sumatra. Now, the third kind of a cone is known as a parasitic cone. Now you again take an example of this cone itself. This is one volcanic eruption which has taken place over a period of time. Now due to dormant period in between, this has got solidified into igneous matter. This cone has got solidified, and as a result of this, the next volcanic eruption, if it's very powerful, it may blow away the top of a mountain for the next volcanic eruption. But if the volcanic eruption is not as powerful, or the supply of the magma is not very large, then it will result into this magma may not rise on the top, but it will branch out in different direction, resulting into formation of smaller cones on one larger cone. So it will result into formation of a smaller cones on a larger cone. Such a cones which are formed after the subsequent volcanic eruption, which is smaller or which is not as powerful, or the cones in which, when there is on a large volcanic cone, there are numerous smaller cones, such cones are known as parasitic cones. So what are these parasitic cones? It is a cone in which several branches of the pipes come out from main pipe and as a result smaller volcanic cones develop on larger cone. Several volcanic cones develop on the larger cone. It is an example of an parasitic cones. The best example in the world of a parasitic cone is, again we have done this mountain. Where is this mountain? It should click very quickly, Mount Shasta in US of A. It is an example of parasitic cones, where the several smaller cones come on the top of many larger cones. Okay. So these are the three major types of that we have done: ash and cinder cones, we have done composite cones, and then we have done parasitic cones. On the Mount Shasta, you will see many smaller cones coming on the larger cone. So when we'll finish with the geomorphology, I will revise the entire concepts of geomorphology with a PowerPoint presentation, and I will again show you what are these different, so that you will get a real idea of how this looks in the real life. The next cone is known as the basic lava cone. What is the characteristics of a basic lava? Why we call it as a basic lava? It has low percentage of which material? Silica. Because it is a low percentage of silica, it has higher fluidity. That is, it flows for a larger distance because it has low viscosity. So it comes out and flows for a very, very larger distance at a great speed before solidifying. And as a result of this, a cone is formed in the basic lava, which is of which is of gentle slope. For example, if a lava is coming from between, from magma is coming from the interior of the earth, as a result of this, the cone before being solidified, it will fall. The lava before getting solidified, it will flow for a larger distance as compared to the acidic lava. On other hand, if the acidic lava is coming out, because it cannot flow for larger distance, it will get solidified. Subsequent volcanic eruption will keep on increasing the height of a volcano, resulting into formation of either composite cone or either ash and cinder cone. But this is of a acidic lava. Don't get confused with this diagram. This is just to make you understand how it is different from this kind of an lava. But in this kind of a basic lava, before the lava can get solidified, it will flow for a larger distance as compared to the basic lava. And because why it flows for a larger distance? Because it has high fluidity, because it can, and therefore it flow, even the subsequent volcanic eruption happens, it will again flow for a larger distance. And as a result of this, the cone will be of a gentle slope. It will be having a gentle slope. So basic lava cones are cones because of having, which are having gentle slope. Which are having gentle slope. Now why gentle slope? Because of higher degree of fluidity. Therefore, they cover or they flow. Because of higher degree of fluidity, therefore they flow for large distance before solidifying. Before solidifying, such lava cones are known as basic lava cones. Or they are also known as shield volcanoes. They are also known as, remember this word, they are also known as shield volcanoes. So what are the shield cones or shield volcanoes? These are the basic lava cones which are having gentle slope. Why they are having gentle slope? Because the basic lava has higher degree of fluidity, so they flow for a larger distance before solidifying, resulting into formation of a gentle slope in such kind of an lavas. This basic lava cones are found in of Hawaii Islands. These are found in the Hawaii Island region. Why they are known as shield? If you look at this part, doesn't it look like a shield which used to be a weapon for defense during the weapon for defending oneself during the old battlefield? So it looks like a shield, therefore they are known as shield volcanoes. So these are the different types of cones known as. So we have done the different types of cones known, starting from ash and cinder cones of a lower height, composite cones of a greater height. These are the highest volcanic cones, why they are highest? Because the lava acts as a cementing material. Then on these such high volcanic cones, there are some smaller cones which develop due to subsequent volcanic eruption. They are known as parasitic cones. And lastly, we have done the basic lava cones which are having gentle slope because of higher degree of fluidity. Now the other kind of a landforms is crater. What is a crater? Crater is an vent or an opening on a volcano. As I told you, how do we generally represent the volcanic mountain? It is represented through this kind of a vent or an opening. Why? Because it is from where here the lava will come out, the smoke and the gas will come out and it will flow. It is not represented as a proper folded mountain or neither as a flat block mountain. This is an example of a fold mountain. This is a diagram of a block mountain. This is a diagram of a volcanic mountain. So crater is a vent or opening through which the magma comes out and flows at a lava. The vent or opening at the top of a volcano is known as a crater. It is a funnel shaped depression which is known as a crater. Sometimes the crater becomes larger in size, then such a larger size crater is known as caldera. Sometimes in a very, very bigger volcanoes, once a volcanic eruption occurs, the volcano may get dormant. As a result of the dormancy, there may be one crater which is formed, but subsequent volcanic eruption may result into formation of another crater inside the main crater. That is, the next volcanic eruption may be a smaller as compared to the first volcanic eruption. Such a crater which is formed inside the crater is known as nested crater. So crater is a, what is a crater? Vent or opening on volcanic mountain. That is a vent or opening or the volcanic mountain, or we can say it is a depression. Very large craters, in size are known as calderas. What is then? Smaller eruptions. Smaller volcanic eruptions. May result into formation of small craters into an existing large craters. Such a crater is known as nested crater. That is a smaller craters inside the large crater. Now Obviously, these volcanic regions are when you'll understand, when we'll come to climatology, we'll see that this there are numerous gases and water vapor act which are released during an volcanic eruption. This water vapor and gases act as an, especially the water vapor and the dust particles act as hygroscopic nuclei which may cause rainfall. And as a result, water vapor is released, humidity is increased. These are the areas which are which also have heavy rainfall. Now due to this, sometimes the water is filled inside the crater. After the solidification of magma and lava, subsequent rainfall, because this is a depression, may result into filling of this depression with water. And as a result, it results into the, as a result, a lake is formed. Such a lake is known as crater lake. Such a lake is known as a crater lake. That is, when the depression, what is a crater lake? Crater lake is when the water collects inside the crater. Water collects inside the crater, resulting into formation of a crater lake. So initially a large one crater is formed. Due to the subsequent volcanic eruption, the size of the crater will increase. We'll call this as a caldera. If there is a volcanic eruption which is later on smaller, it will result into formation of nested craters. It will result into the formation of nested craters, that is the crater inside the crater. It will result into formation of a nested crater. If a water is filled inside the crater, it will result into the formation of a lake. Such a lake is known as a crater lake. So crater is vent or opening on a volcanic mountain. It is a funnel shaped depression. The craters which are larger in size are known as calderas. Smaller volcanic eruption may result into formation of a smaller crater into an existing large crater. Such craters inside the crater is known as a nested crater. When the water collects inside the crater, it results into formation of a lake. Such a lake is known as a crater lake. Are there any new examples of a crater lake in the world? Yes, there are numerous examples, but out of which these are the most important examples are. Examples of a crater lake in the world are Lake Toba in Sumatra. In Sumatra, which that is Indonesia. Lake Fujiyama. Japan on Mount Fuji or Mount Fuji, which we have done as a composite cone. Crater Lake in USA. Crater Lake in USA. Lake Krakatoa again in Sumatra, Indonesia. So these are the important crater lakes of the world, out of which you remember Lake Toba and Lake Fujiyama. More importantly, this the top three lakes are very, very important, which can be asked in match the column. So crater, or this is again a kind of an extrusive igneous landforms or extrusive volcanic landforms, which is a kind of a depression resulting into formation of a larger crater known as caldera. Crater inside a crater is known as rested crater, and when the water is filled in the crater, it is known as a crater lake. Crater lake results, there are major examples are Lake Toba, Lake Fujiyama, and crater lakes in USA. The next kind of an volcanic landforms are volcanic plateaus. That is, what is a plateau? A table like landform which has been, it is a table landform. It is having a, what do you mean by table like landform? That is having a flat surface but with steep sides, similar to a table. So it is known as a volcanic plateau. So this flat table like landform, here what you have to remember from the exam point of view, it has a little chance of being asked as an as a mains question, but it will result in what it will be, it can be asked as a where which of the following are the volcanic plateaus. So some of the important volcanic plateaus of the world are some of the important volcanic plateaus in the world are, first, Deccan Plateau, India. Deccan Lava Plateau. Siberian Plateau. Siberia, Russia. In Siberia, Russia. Parana, Paraguay Plateau region, South America. Colombia Snake Plateau, USA. Icelandic Plateau, Iceland. Icelandic Plateau, Iceland. North Island Plateau in New Zealand. This island is in the north, so North Island Plateau of New Zealand. So the North Islandic Plateau of New Zealand. That is, these are some of the very important volcanic plateau in the world. Again, some of the other important plateaus are the island of Java in Indonesia. You can take the island of Java in Indonesia. Island of Java in Indonesia. So these are the major volcanic plateaus of the world. There are two small concepts which are related to the volcanoes. They are geysers and hot springs. Have you experienced what a geyser is? Have you seen a geyser? What is a geyser? Geyser is something from where hot water comes out. It is also known as hot spring. These are the major tourist destination, and also they have some benefits in the terms of they are good for skin problems. So what are these geysers and hot springs? Now, or why the hotter water becomes hot in this region? Now, take for example this diagram. Suppose this is an area where there is an which has a history of a volcanic eruption in the terms of an volcano or in the terms of an volcanic plateau. That means somewhere down there is a molten magma which is coming up. Somewhere down there is a formation of a sill or dikes in this region. Now, if this part of a rock structure, if this is a part of a rock structure underground, jahan pe there is presence of a groundwater in this part of a rock structure. If there is a presence of a groundwater in the rocks, this groundwater will get obviously heated up. And as a result of this, this groundwater will come out in the form of a spring. That is hot spring. So this water will be an obviously hot water. Why hot water? It is hot water because it is coming in contact with this magma or lava. It is coming in contact with this magma. It is heating up of the water. So the geysers and hot springs are associated with volcanic eruption. What is a hot spring? A hot spring is an area where hot water comes out from the ground. Why the water is hot? When there is a hot water, it shows that the area is having a history or was having the history of an volcanic eruption. So the hot water, when the hot water comes out from the ground, it is known as a hot spring. So what is the geyser? Geyser and hot spring are defined only on the basis of interval. If there is a continuous flow of a groundwater, then it is known as a hot spring or spring, when there is a continuous flow of a groundwater. But if the groundwater is coming out at some intervals, maybe after every 2 days or after every 10 days or after every 1 hour, then it is known as a geyser. So the difference between hot spring and a geyser is, hot spring is when groundwater, when hot groundwater sprouts or comes out, comes out continuously, then it is known as a hot spring, and geyser is in when the hot water comes down in the when the hot water does comes out irregularly, or we can say at intervals, it is known as geysers. When the hot water comes out irregularly or at intervals, then it is known as a geyser. So this is the only difference between the hot water, between the hot spring and the geysers, which is are their location. In India there are numerous places where there are geysers. We will do it that in Indian geography, but some of the important geysers in the world are, there are maximum amount of geysers found in Yellowstone National Park of USA, where one of the best known geyser in the world is Old Faithful Geyser, second is Iceland. As we have done, it is an example of an volcanic plateau. Why is the Iceland formed? Because of the coming up of the magma below, from below the surface of the earth and above the water, and getting solidified, because the Iceland lies on the mid oceanic ridge. So Iceland is an example of an geyser. Geyser land is an example of an volcanic landform. There are geysers, so many geysers, that Iceland is known as a land of geysers. Geysers are also found in New Zealand region. In New Zealand region. So the geysers and hot springs are when the hot water comes out continuously. When the hot water is it is an hot spring. When the hot water comes out irregularly or at intervals, it is known as a geyser. The Old Faithful Geyser is one of the world's best known geysers. It is found in the Yellowstone National Park in USA. While there are numerous geysers in Iceland and in the New Zealand region. Now, one more concept, the last concept in the volcanic eruption is the fumaroles. Now imagine this, if there is no water here, or if the volcano is in the dying stage, that means it does not have that much power that it will flow as a magma and come out on the surface of the earth. But obviously it is in the dying state, so there is the magma is coming and getting solidified somewhere below the surface of the earth. If this magma is getting solidified even in this region, and on the top of it there is a very less water, but there are numerous number of gases. Now if these are gases here, then the water, instead of water, some kind of a smoke will come out. Such kind of a smoke which comes out from the surface of the earth is known as fumaroles. So instead of gases, there is a emission of, so instead of water in the hot spring, there is an emission of gases and water vapor. Such are known as fumaroles. So what are the fumaroles? When there is an emission of gases and water vapor, instead of water comes out in the, if there is an emission of water here, it will be known as a spring. If there is emission of a gases and water vapor, there will be known as the fumarole. So when there is an emission of gases and water vapor, they are known as the fumaroles. Generally, these hot springs and geysers and the fumaroles are rich in sulfur, and that's why they are very good for treating skin disease problems. If you want to have a practical example, when you keep milk for boiling, so the milk boils, and if you don't still remove the milk from the gas, the milk will start evaporating. It will evaporate until a certain limit, and after that, when the entire milk evaporates, the milk starts getting burnt. After that, when the milk also gets finished, and if you still by mistake leave the gas on, you will see that there are the vessel in which you have kept the milk starts burning, and large amount of gases or large amount of smoke starts coming out. Now, what does it show? That there is no milk to be boiled. That is why the vessel starts burning and large amount of smoke is coming out. Same thing you can apply it to the volcanoes. When there is large amount of magma comes out. When the magma is of less amount, and if it on the top there is a groundwater, the groundwater comes out in the form of a hot spring. Once even the groundwater gets exhausted, even the magma is not there, but still there is high temperature inside the earth, the gases expand and they come out from that opening, resulting into the fumaroles. Now, does this means that the fumaroles shows the last stage of the volcanic activity. These occur in the last stage, and they are activities which occur just before the extinction, death of a volcano. So remember that the foreman, or we can say, it shows that after the fumaroles, there is no magma to come out, the volcano won't be active now. What do you mean by active volcano? That is, there is a continuous volcanic eruption. Dormant means the volcano has not erupted for a long, long time. Extinct means the volcano has not erupted in the recent past. So what are the fumaroles? The fumaroles are last stage. It is a last stage or last sign of activeness of volcano. So these are the fumaroles. So we have finished with the topic of volcano. What are the different types of questions we can expect here is, from the mains examination point of view, what are volcanoes? Describe the process of volcanic eruption or volcanism. Question next you can expect is, explain volcanoes with plate tectonic theory. Next is, explain different types of volcanic landforms. Explain the different types of volcanic landforms. So what are volcanoes? How do you distinguish from volcanism? We already know how does the plate tectonic theory explain volcanoes, and what are the different type of volcanic landforms we have done today as intrusive landforms and extrusive landforms. Intrusive landforms are sill, dike, laccolith, facolith, batholith and lupolith, while the extrusive landforms are the volcanic cones, volcanic craters, volcanic plains and volcanic plateaus. Or they can ask you a very simple question, what do you mean by geyser? Distinguish between the geyser and hot spring. So this is the very simple topic, you can relate it to the volcanic chapter. Now the next topic which we are going to study is the earthquakes.